and welcome to episode 27 of Popcorn and Prosecco, a show that is all about movies, movies, and more movies. I'm Perri Nemiroff, and here are my co-hosts, Kristy, Puchko, and Angie Han.
Hey, everybody.
All right, so this week we are going to talk about a new limited release, Frank, and we're also going to talk about our favorite Robin Williams movies, and then we're going to wrap up with a review of The Giver, but we're starting off with Frank, and I am hosting that one. So it stars Domhnall Gleeson, who's the guy in Star Wars, because, like, he wasn't really all that famous before all this shit happened, but, like, now he's going to be huge.
I think last year when he did About Time with, like, one of his, like,
and
one
and
of the...
Really, he's like all About Time, but us.
Well, it was bigger in England, I think.
I guess
it's a bigger deal there.
He was also technically in Harry Potter as, like, one of the Weasley brothers, in case you couldn't guess by his bright red hair.
The ittiest bitty role I've ever seen in my life. He didn't
he's the one that marries Fleur, right? So that's pretty sweet.
At least he got that out of it. Anyway, he plays a guy named, I believe his name is John in this, and he works in, like, a cubicle-type job, so, like, a button pusher all the time, but he dreams of being a musician. So one day, he kind of takes a risk, and he jumps in a van with this eccentric, like, weird band, and the band is led by a guy named Frank, and Frank is a man, but he wears that big head that I'm sure you've seen over his own head all the time, and not just when they perform. I mean, like, in the shower, everywhere. And so John joins their group, and they go off to Ireland, and in Ireland they're going to record a record together, and then it gets kind of crazy from there. I liked Frank. I liked the tone. It was different. It kind of wasn't what I was expecting. I thought that they were going to lean a little more on the whole shtick of having Michael Fassbender wear a mask the whole time, but that worked really well, where it wasn't like, look at what we're doing. It's like, this is why this guy is like that, and I'm going to make sure you understand it. So I really appreciated that part of it.
Yeah, I mean, I thought that the movie, at first I thought it was going to be, like, I was like, oh, this is going to be so, like, self-consciously quirky. Like, there was a guy with a head, and, like, there was a guy, like, Domhnall Gleeson's character just kind of sings about things that are happening to him. But it actually, like, it really gets to, like, why these people are this way, and, like, you know, the kind of good and bad things about it. One thing I really appreciate about this movie is that at first I thought it was going to be, like, you know, like, an uplifting, like, oh, art and music and inspirational and whatnot, but it really doesn't sugarcoat, like, the bad things about it. Like,
it gets pretty dark.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like, there's a lot of
heated arguments here.
There's a lot of stuff about, like, you know, fame versus creativity and, like, you know, the fact that not everyone necessarily has the talent to be the, you know, to put their work out there and, like, you know, the bad parts of mental illness, because I feel like a lot of times in these kinds of things, mental illness is glorified, like, oh, it's, like, what makes someone special and creative, but this movie isn't like that, so I really appreciate that.
It's interesting. I went into this partially because of the trailers. I thought it was going to be kind of like Little Miss Sunshine, where it was going to be a story about these underdogs who have their moment, because, like, as the trailer teases, they get invited to South by Southwest, which, funny enough, the movie played at South by Southwest. So that's kind of funny. But anyway, but, like, it's not really about that. It's not about these people, like, finding their niche and becoming great. I was surprised at how unlikable the main character is, because the main character is not Frank. The movie's
about
Frank.
He's not unlikable at the start. He definitely becomes
it. John starts off as, and also because it's, I think his name is pronounced Donal Gleeson or Donal Gleeson.
You know, that's, like, starting to bug me now. I've heard so many different pronunciations, and apparently that was a major thing at the junket, so I'm
at
just like,
day, yeah.
You know,
I just avoided
I'm going to say
name.
It the way I want
Let's
it right now.
Let's just call him Gleeson. How about that?
Mr. Gleeson.
It was a thing at the press day where everyone told me that if you pronounce his name wrong, they'll explain it to you, and I got so nervous that I just went out of my way not to say his name, to the point where I called him Michael Fassbender's buddy in a joint interview. So you can watch that on Cinema Blend. That's something that happened.
Yeah, I feel like people really appreciate it when you don't say their name, but you just say, like, oh, Perry's friend.
Because I was just like, don't call me out of it, don't call me out of it.
The next time I introduce the show, I'm just going to be, and here are my friends. And you don't even get an introduction.
You can only get away with that if you introduce it wearing a giant papier-mâché head.
I would do it.
But yeah, I liked it okay. I ultimately didn't like what I felt it had to say about, I just kind of didn't like its point of view. I thought it was kind of a negative movie, which bummed me out, when I thought it was going to be this joyous celebration of creativity, and really, it's more of a portrait of someone who dreams of being a musical genius but doesn't have the skill set for it. Because John wants to be Frank, and he's not. And it's a weird story. And I like Donald Gleason. I love Anna Karenina. I thought About Time was outstanding. I think he's a very good actor. I don't think he's the right person for this part because he just has this kind of affability about him that doesn't sit with the character of John. Because no one in the movie likes John, which is weird because he just seems so sweet and unassuming. And then, like, when you realize that he's not sweet, it still feels jarring to me that Donald Gleason's playing him.
I don't necessarily blame that on casting as much as I do just, like, that's what was in the script. It's like, it just took this dark turn eventually where it's like they were all hopeful about their music and then all of a sudden something switched. And it's not even before they reveal what's really going on with Frank. It's before that, where people start to get, like it's not even just, like, a playful, you know, poking fun at people. People start to get mean.
Oh, no, they're hostile. They're, like,
they get mean. You know, that's why I didn't like Maggie Gyllenhaal in this movie. I thought her character was just way too much of a bitch. She totally sucked the life out of, like all the fun out of that movie.
I liked her.
I thought she was hilarious.
Yeah, I thought she was really funny because, like, I understood her in Frank's world, where John and Frank's world never really made sense to me. And it makes sense that he doesn't make sense because that's kind of what the movie's saying. But ultimately for me, I thought Frank is an interestingly made movie, but I found it to be kind of a downer, and I wasn't really into it.
It is a downer.
That's so weird, because I feel like what you guys didn't like about it, which is that it's a downer and that it's, like, not positive, is what I liked about it. Like, I feel like I've seen so many versions of this movie where, like, you know, there's, like, a dreamer, and he's, like, you know, kind of scrappy, and he's an underdog, and then he makes it big, and he's, like,
and everyone's good at something.
And everyone cheers, yeah. And
you know, I'm sure I would be complaining if they had, like, become famous rock stars and all that stuff.
And to me, it made, like, the fact that he kind of just seemed like a weird, like, it made complete sense to me why the other characters don't like him. I do think that he's affable, and I think that that actually works in his favor, because I don't think you're meant to, like, hate John or think that he's, like, a horrible person. He's not. Like, he's not as, like, you know, pure as he maybe seems at first, but I don't think he's a horrible person. Like, the whole time, I kind of understood, like, you know, his motivations and, like, what he's doing. He wants what a lot of people want, which is to be successful and famous and, to create things. So to me, that wasn't, it wasn't weird. I don't know.
I connected much more to what he was going for versus Maggie Gyllenhaal's character. Like, it never really clicked in my head as much why she was standing by Frank's side all this time.
I just thought she was, like, in love with him. It seemed like this kind of impossible love because Frank, I mean, how do you have a relationship with someone who wears a papier-mâché head all the time?
I guess that's the one thing that the papier-mâché head acting didn't sell as well to me, though. I think it's more of, like, a relatability factor. Like, I can connect with the fact that, you know, John's a guy who looks at this other guy and he's like, I want to be like you, you know, versus what she wants.
Can we talk about Michael Fassbender's acting in this? Because, like, you know,
it's so wild,
he's very much handicapped by the fact that he's wearing this giant head, so you can never see what his facial expressions are. Although Frank has this charming thing where he, like, says, like,
new smile,
like, because he knows that people can't see his face. But, like, one of the things that was really interesting to me about it was that, this is the most, like, sweet and innocent and fragile and vulnerable that I've seen Michael Fassbender.
And goofy.
He literally skips
in this movie.
Yeah.
You know what's funny? I did the press day last week. And the week before, whatever. And I didn't know. I'd never spoken to Michael Fassbender before, so I wasn't sure how that was gonna go. And and everyone was like, "He's being real weird." And I walk in like, and was just kind of nervous, being like, "Weird." And like, he's so playful as a human being that like, I was like, "Oh, obviously you did, Frank." Like we sang together. We ended up singing One Night in Bangkok, guys. It was a weird day. But like, yeah, it's like when you meet him, the movie makes tons more sense. Also, he has an American accent in this movie, so that's also, like, another, like, layer to the character that you don't really expect.
I thought that because it's, like, you know, the main character is British and it's set in Ireland, I was like, well, naturally he's going to use his natural accent. Nope, he's from, like, Kansas.
Yeah.
I think that was probably really important to the character, too. If they had cast an actor with a more familiar voice and you heard that coming out of the head, odds are it wouldn't have worked as well. But, like, he didn't really sound like Michael Fassbender because he had that other accent.
No, and it was
like we said, Fassbender's normally, like, in this place, and it's a dark mood, and da-da-da-da. And, like, then in this movie, it's this, like, he has, like, this, it's like an, he sounds like a child. His voice is, like, always kind of wonderful and, like, joyful, and there's always, like, an upbeat to it, and it's like he's on a kid's show or something, but, like, a really fucked up kid's show.
Yeah. And he speaks his emotions. I think that might be one of my favorite scenes in the film.
That is my favorite scene.
And he really does, like, he projects enough, like, magnetism that when you're watching the movie, it makes total sense to you why Frank, this weirdo who has a paper head on all the time, has, like, so, you know, has so many people that just, like, worship him.
Yeah, and he would totally be a hipster icon. I mean, it is based on a real character called Frank Sidebottom, which is, like, a comic persona, blah, 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 blah. But it's, like, it's a spun-off thing. But it's, like, if you think if there was a band in Brooklyn where someone was wearing a papier-mâché head at all times, it would be a thing.
Oh, my God. I was looking at someone, because the characters, the other characters, not even the ones with the papier-mâché heads, they're more regular-looking ones, even they wear some weird shit, but I was like, oh, if you walk down the street in Williamsburg wearing that, no one would bat an eye.
You know, it's a really great marketing thing, too. I mean, I know the important thing is about incorporating the head in the story, but, like, do you remember at Sundance when the movie played there, they handed out those masks?
Yeah.
I can't even begin to tell you how many times I saw a picture of those masks when I was sorting through my Instagram feed. And it's fun. It's just, like, a fun thing to post a picture of, so good job for them. All right, you guys want to move on?
Yeah, we'll move on. So
are we recommending Frank? Because we've kind of gone back and forth.
Yes.
I think it's worth seeing. I just kind of would give a warning that it's not quite the uplifting movie its trailer suggests it is.
I'd say that it needs to look really interesting to you right now. If it looks really interesting to you, you might like it. There's a good shot you'll like it. But if you're like, you know, this looks weird just by looking at the trailer, like, don't even bother.
I don't think it's for everyone, but, you know, I liked it, and I would say that you should, I'm going to tell people it's not the uplifting movie you think it's going to be. So I'm going to say it's the same thing as Kristy, but in a completely different town.
That makes sense. All right, so we are going to move on now. Kristy, you're going to take this one?
Yeah, we're going to move on to a little bit of tribute of Robin Williams, who, of course, died earlier this week. And it caused a lot of us to look over his career and to kind of think about the impact he had on all of us. So each of us have decided to choose one movie from Robin Williams that we wanted to talk about and talk about why we love it and why it matters to us. So I spent a lot of time thinking about two movies from my childhood, in particular Aladdin and Hook, which I've watched both infinite times. But I'm going to go with Hook because for me, Hook was just, I've watched Hook more times than I can count at this point, and for those who haven't maybe watched it, it's an idea of a kind of sequel to Peter Pan, where Peter Pan did eventually leave Neverland. Now, you know, 30 or 40 years has passed, he is a corporate attorney, and he's kind of a jackass, and his kids don't like him, and he's kind of totally lost priorities, and like, he's forgotten what matters in the world, and he goes to England to visit Auntie Wendy, and his children are abducted because Hook has taken them, and so he has to go to Never Neverland and reunite with Tinkerbell and all the Lost Boys and fight Hook, but first he has to rediscover his inner child, he has to discover his Pan and fight pirates, and I loved this movie so intensely when I was a kid because it was funny, and a huge part of that was Robin Williams, and like watching it again, the other night when I was actually on vacation with my family and we heard the news, and so everybody decided that night we wanted to watch a Robin Williams movie, and Hook is streaming on Netflix, so it's easy to watch and you should totally take advantage. And it was hard at moments because there's, you know, there's some darker moments of Hook. There's death in Hook.
Hook used to scare me as a kid.
Hook has
like
scary moments.
That scene where they come home from the banquet dinner and, like, Maggie Smith is, like, huddled in the hallway, I always just get really scared that
I remember, I was actually, like, clapping my hands watching it because I still very earnestly remembered seeing it in theaters and how much it meant to me. I actually went with two girls who wanted to see JFK, but we couldn't get in. I don't know why that was what happened, but we went to see Hook, and Hook was outstanding. And it's so fun, and we were watching it with, like, little kids who had never seen it before, and they were just drop-jawed and fixated, and the rest of us were laughing and quoting along with the lines, and it's just really wonderful because you get to watch Robin Williams, like, act and do, like, the, like, whatever, and you get to see him do really wonderful slapstick and there's the scene at the end where a couple of Devendra, who we know, and Katie Rich from Vanity Fair were both saying that they couldn't imagine watching Hook that night. And I said, you know, tonight I'm going to cry for Rufio and I'm going to cry for Robin. And it felt really, really cathartic, and I'm glad that we made that choice. And I highly recommend watching Hook because it's really funny, and I feel like it does give a catharsis where you can kind of remember Robin Williams for what a wonderful performer he was and how much imagination and joy he brought into our lives, and then have that moment where you can cry and it's totally okay.
Aw, that was really nice. I'm going to be far less eloquent. I'll go next. My movie was Mrs. Doubtfire, and I had a similar relationship to that movie growing up. In fact, I still have the VHS at home, and I still have the same TV. When I was a kid, I was like 5 years old, and my grandparents bought for Hanukkah, both Lonnie and I, we got, you know, those big box set TVs, and it had a VCR built into the top, and at the time, that VCR being built into the TV was like the biggest freaking deal in the world.
That was swank.
You know, if we have any younger viewers, they're like, what's a VCR?
Seriously. That same TV is still the one that I use in my room when I go to my parents' house, but I went through a phase where I would always fall asleep with the TV on as a kid, but I would put a tape in so that eventually the tape would shut off and the TV would shut off. And basically what would happen is, like, for, like, months at a time, the same tape would sit in there, and for a good chunk of time, that tape was Mrs. Doubtfire. Because, you know, it makes you feel all warm and fuzzy inside, and it kind of makes you feel like Mrs. Doubtfire is almost like your nanny as a kid, too. Like, I just looked at her, and I'm like, you know, I wouldn't mind if, like, a man dressed up as a woman was taking care of me, because that looks like a freaking blast. And now I just think about all those moments and all those lines. I actually have the IMDb page open right now, and it's stuck on a picture of her. You know when, like, the woman comes in and she sticks, and Robin sticks to me.
Oh, hello!
I freaking love that part. There's just so many things about this movie that I love, and you know, we don't really have comedies like this anymore, where it can be like that slapstick type humor, but then circle back and be really warm and touching and make you connect to all the material at the same time.
And
I think it's because of him.
It was also groundbreaking in that it talked about a divorced family and dealing with that. And you know, I know a lot of people look to that movie for help and for support when their own parents were splitting up.
My dad did not love me enough to dress up as a woman and come back as a housekeeper. And now I feel abandoned. Thanks a lot, Kristy.
Thanks,
that
Mom.
Was really good. I just wanted to needle Angie because her dad doesn't cross-dress.
That'd be a great Halloween costume, you know. Seriously. I think
a lot of Mrs. Doubtfires this year.
I wouldn't be surprised if that happened, and I think Mrs. Doubtfire would be a top choice for a costume, but you know, that movie is Robin Williams. That would not have been the same with any other person in there, and I will watch it all the time. And again, I see right now, it's on Amazon Instant Video, so you could watch it right after the show if you wanted. Not right now, but right after our show.
Because you need to know what we think about other movies.
Well, like you guys, I also grew up watching the same movies that you guys talked about, but the one I wanted to talk about today is something I saw when I was a little bit older, and it's Dead Poets Society, which I saw in English class, which in retrospect seems like a weird thing for an English teacher to do, because they're like, look at this teacher who is much better at their job than I am, because, you know, if a teacher is showing you a movie in English class like that, then that means that day they're phoning it in. But anyway... I rewatched.
I kind of want you to name drop the teacher and be like, "I'm talking to you, Mrs. Englewood."
No, these teachers were good teachers otherwise, but I think they all had their days and they're just like, you know what? I can't fucking be bothered. Let's just put on the TV and the kids will shut up. Anyway, but I rewatched it and it's not that good of a movie, honestly. Like if I saw it now, I probably would just be like, ugh. But like at the time that I saw it, which was like, you know, early high school. It was really inspirational, and I thought that it felt to me like a really fitting tribute to Robin Williams, because the whole movie is about, like, you know, like, well, it's about poetry, but, you know, art, I guess, in a more general sense, and, like, how it has the power to, like, move people, and how it's, like, what makes us human, and, like, you know, how something like that can just, like, transcend, like, all barriers, and, you know, that's why we loved Robin Williams so much. Like, that's why we are so sad that he's gone, because of the work that he's done. And it's not one of his more characteristic performances because he's not as like shticky. He's not as like big. He's more restrained. He has like a couple moments where he like does that, but for the most part, it's not. But to me, it just felt like you know, here's this guy that I grew up watching, like, and that I had such, like, a relationship to because I would always watch him on TV and, like, you know, make me feel things, make me feel happy or sad, like, watching his movies. And so watching this, it just kind of felt perfect in that sense.
A lot of this stuff is on TV. They have Dead Poets Society on, you know, the higher movie channels now, like the HBO and Stars and all that. They just keep playing his movies over and over. Lonnie was watching Dead Poets Society the other night, and I was doing work, so I shouldn't have been, but every time I'd walk into the kitchen, I'd have to be like, that part, I want to stay
and watch it some more. Than I remembered. Not as much as I remembered. I thought that he was, like, in the whole movie, but then I was like, oh, right, because I hadn't watched it in a few years, and I was like, oh, right, he's not the protagonist. The protagonist is the guy from House.
Yeah, that was one of his movies that I haven't rewatched. It's funny, I'd say probably some of the comedians that I tend to rewatch over and over again are Jim Carrey, Adam Sandler, and Robin Williams. That tends to be, like, the group that made my childhood, but, you know, when it comes to something like Dead Poets Society, I watched it a couple times, and then it's been, like, a 10-year gap, I think, between when I last seen it.
I watched it a bunch in high school because I feel like every year some teacher would, like, wheel it out on the day they had a hangover, but I hadn't watched it probably at least.
I never noticed that when I was a kid. Apparently I had the wrong teachers.
Well, I'm just exaggerating. I don't want
to take it back. You know what I got to watch in health class? We watched Freaks and Geeks every day in health class. I mean, like, we never even did class. Every day they would start either a new episode of Freaks and Geeks or Boston Public.
They showed a lot of movies in my religion class, but, like, it was never what you want. It was like they would show a movie, and then they would want you to, like, pick it apart and all. I didn't want to get into it. It was really frustrating.
I saw Howard the Duck in my calculus class 1 minute at a time. It's a really long story, but we had a weird calculus program.
Wow. Before we tap out with Robin Williams talk, I just want to point out the Netflix Instant also has, besides Hook, they also have The Birdcage and Jumanji streaming.
Jumanji!
Yeah.
I was debating between picking Mrs. Doubtfire and Jumanji. I loved Jumanji as a kid.
It's really easy to make yourselves a Robin Williams marathon this weekend, so the reason for it is sad, but, you know, embrace it and have a good weekend.
Well, on that note, let's switch to The Giver. That was a bad transition, but what am I going to do about it?
Okay, yeah. No, I got a transition. Uncut and you knew this one. You should watch one of those Robin Williams classics because they're probably better than The Giver.
All right.
So The Giver is a dystopian YA adventure because aren't they all these days?
Wow, my sigh was so loud that the camera cut to me.
But the thing is, like, this, so it's based on a book, you know, it's, okay, so the plot is that there's this boy named Jonas who's played by Brenton Thwaites, and he lives in a society where everything's, like, where people have, like, no emotions, and there's no color, and there's no, like, feeling or pleasantness or unpleasantness or anything. But it turns out that that's basically because they just have, like, one guy, played by Jeff Bridges, who was assigned to, like, remember all the really good and really bad shit so that no one else has to remember that any of that stuff happened. And then when Jonas comes of age, he's assigned to be, like, the next in line to, like, basically take over Jeff Bridges' job. And the more he, like, learns about, like, you know, like, the truth about human history, and, like, the more he learns about, like, the good and the bad things that used to exist, the more he, like, starts to get upset about, like, how his society has, like, it just eliminated all that has become so sterilized. So then him and the Giver, Jeff Bridges, hatch a plan to try and change that. So that's the plot. It sounds like every other YA movie we've seen. And the really disappointing thing is it's kind of like what happened, I guess, when John Carter came out a few years ago, where it felt so derivative of everything else that came before, even though the book actually came out way before that stuff. That's what happened with The Giver. This is a book that came out in, I think, like, 1993. I read it when I was a kid. Like, this is way before Katniss Everdeen was a thing, way before even, like, Twilight or Harry Potter were things.
Yeah, but that's not even an okay excuse because the book is nothing like those books.
No,
they just made the movie like those movies.
I'm
so, like, technically
that, like,
you can blame them for that because that's what they did.
I'm not saying that. I'm saying that's part of the problem, but the other problem is that, like, they've been trying to make this movie basically since then, but I think what kind of finally got it made was the fact that dystopian Y is a big trend now, and maybe because of that they basically turned it into Divergent. Like, it feels so much, or, like, you know, like that kind
what
of movie.
What a waste of good stars.
It's so disappointing. Like, the book is actually, like, very different from those. When you read the plot outline, it sounds similar, but the book has a much more different tone. It's much more, like, melancholy and, like, much more cerebral, much less, like, action-packed. But they had to, like, juice all that stuff up for the movie. And as a result, the movie just feels so, like, it just feels like so much, like, we've seen this before, like, there's, like, nothing special here. And on top of that, even when you take it outside of that context, like, I just don't think it's a very well-made movie. There are moments that I liked.
It's really poorly written. It's poorly written and poorly acted. Minus Jeff Bridges. I didn't even think Meryl Streep was that good in this.
I thought that the acting was okay. Like, Brenton Thwaites was actually way better than I expected.
He was
way more charismatic than I expected.
I think I would have enjoyed his performance more if his character was actually developed a little more. I have two really big problems with this movie. And, like, I understand that when a book that you love is adapted to film, you need to just let go of everything you love because it's two different mediums. It needs to be changed.
You shouldn't have to let go of everything you love, though.
What?
I said, you shouldn't have to let go of everything you love.
Well, and that's what happens here. You literally just lose the entire book. Like, half the fun of reading a book like that is so you could see this situation that is, like, nothing like the world that we live in today, look at what these people are going through, and be like, wow, could you imagine if the world was in black and white? Could you imagine if I couldn't find the words to describe this feeling that I'm feeling? Or what if I just had to, you know, live by their rules and have a job at 12 and all that stuff? And you don't have that in the movie, because what happens in the movie is the movie starts and they're just like, this is the world. Here is this world, this world, this world, this world. We are just going to tell it all to you. You're not going to experience it all. In the book, meet Jonas and you're walking through daily life with him. He doesn't really explain anything. It's just like there's this big thing coming up and I'm having this feeling and I can't describe it. And you can get inside his head and understand where he's coming from. Here it's just like, hey, high school graduation. Let's go into a ceremony that looks like a choosing ceremony from Divergent. Like,
yeah,
that's what it is. And, you know, they describe the rules of this world in a couple of ways that I swear to God were just structured like the same exact like way that they stated the rules of Divergent.
It felt very, like, Divergent. And I think that you also got to, like, something that I thought was a huge problem with this movie is that, like, so what is happening is there's, like, a society that's one way, and then this, you know, someone comes in and shakes up the status quo. But the movie never does a good job of, like, establishing what the status quo is. You don't have any good sense of, like, what this world is like or why it's like that or, like, who these people are before shit starts happening.
Well, right in the beginning of the movie, you know, what happens is you get a shot of Jonas, and I think he's on his bike, and he looks up at the sun, and the camera holds on the sun for a couple seconds, where it's like, obviously this thing is important, but nobody who read the book is going to get why that's important. Like, on our way out, I saw it with Angie and my sister hasn't read the book, or just hasn't read it in God knows how many years or something, and she didn't remember anything, and when we walked out, she's like, oh, that's why he was looking at the sun. You're not going to get that. No one's going to get that. There's a lot of details like that.
So it's not so much Easter eggs, it's like crucial plot stuff that's missed?
I wouldn't say it's missed. I think it's just, it's conveyed in a really disorderly and poor fashion where you can't understand. It's like the facts are there, but like the facts don't come. It's sloppy. Like, the facts aren't coming at the right time, and they're not coming in a way where, like, you're digesting it and thinking about it either.
I also feel like they completely changed the tone of the book, which is much, like, more quiet and much more thoughtful than this movie is. This one is much more, like, action-driven. It's much more,
romance.
Like...
romance.
Yeah, there's, like, more romance, there's more
that
thrill.
That bumped me a little. That might be one thing that I was precious about, though, that upset me. I don't like what they did with Asher, like, taking away from what that character used to be and then amping up what Fiona is. Because in the book, he didn't have any romance with Fiona. You know, he looked at her and he saw the flicker in her hair and all that stuff, but they weren't hiding out in some, like, waterfall. All right, wait, actually, the fucking waterfall. Why would they go through the waterfall? Like, she has to go to work. If you step through the waterfall and then step back out, you are, like, freaking soaked.
Let me explain this. To people who haven't seen the movie, in the middle of this town, which apparently none of these people have any feelings about anything, so it's built on extremely practical and, like, pleasant, but, like, that's it, no frills, you know? But for some reason, in the middle of the town, there's, like, a triangle of hedges, and there's, like, a waterfall in the hedges, and these kids just hang out in there all the time, meaning they go through the waterfall, they get soaking wet, and nobody's ever like, why are you guys always hanging out in a waterfall and getting soaking wet? And
like, they get high.
On their way to work.
I thought that maybe that was so they could hide from the monitoring system.
No,
but, like, then they see them in there. So, like, what's the freaking point?
Also, it's not like if you're soaking wet, it's not like people don't know that you've just been through a fucking waterfall.
I know.
It's like the worst plan ever.
She comes out of the waterfall, and she's dripping from head to toe, and she's like, I have to go to work now. like, just goes off soaking wet.
I don't know. I felt like the whole movie was, like, full of details like that that made no sense. Like, the fact that everyone in this society is effectively colorblind, and yet their dresses are, like, she's wearing this, like, really pretty blue dress. I'm like, why would your dress be a really pretty, trendy shade of blue when you can't see color?
It's also another thing that I think you brought it up, because in the movie, the characters are supposed to have kind of graduated high school, like, that kind of age, and in the book, they're kids. So it would kind of make sense that those kids of that age would grow up and kind of believe everything they hear. And here it's just like you're looking at them and you're like, you're stupid. That's just like common sense. Like, forget the rules of your world. But then also, I really didn't like the whole thing that they introduced with the map either. That, I think, completely took away from it. Half the mystery of the book and half the excitement of Jonas doing what he did is like, you really don't know what's out there. You don't know if maybe they're the last people on Earth or what. And this kind of, I mean, it doesn't give away all the answers. It doesn't tell you, you know, what's out there and what their circumstances are. But it definitely, knowing what's beyond the city, definitely takes away from Jonas's quest.
It's an element that they added to the movie that it's not in the books. They added it to the movie to give it more like a traditional YA thriller structure. And I felt like it didn't work at all.
I feel like it was also there to give Jonas a more tangible goal, which is just really a dumbed-down role, because, goal, I mean, is it a spoiler to say what happens?
Yeah, I wouldn't get too much into it.
All right, well, I mean, basically, if he does this, this happens, and it's literally just stated like that, so it's like, oh, okay, he's gonna go do that now, like, that's what the goal is, so, it's just, like, not that exciting. And, like, I didn't like the drone stuff either, the drone pilots. There's flying, like, spaceship, like, drone ships here. Like, we didn't need any of that.
The more I thought about this movie, the more, like, after I watched it, I was like, well, I liked it better than I expected, because, honestly, I was expecting a disaster, and it's not a disaster. But the more I thought about it, the more I was like, it's really disappointing, just this movie in general, but also, you know, just this movie by itself is disappointing, but it's even more disappointing considering, like, you know, based on the book, how much potential it had, thought that it had to be better than this.
This was probably one of the only instances where I couldn't disconnect from how much I loved the book, just because there wasn't much there for the movie itself at all. Normally, I'm really good. Like, really, with, you know, with all the Hunger Games movies and Divergent stuff and anything else that's come out, I've wrote reviews that are from a critic's perspective, like, without even considering the book, just, is this a good movie or it's not? And then I write one as a fan, so, like, I can gush about the parts that were kept that I like, the new things and all that. Like, I don't even think I could do that for this one, just because, like, there's nothing to the movie. There's, like, no depth, there's no layers, there's nothing for me to connect to this movie, like, as a standalone entity. So all I could think the entire time I'm watching this is, I'm like, fuck, this sucks, and it could have been better if you just stuck to that.
It felt like it had all the standard tropes of the, you know, modern dystopian YA thriller, and then it didn't add anything to them at all. I don't know. Like, I know that, so Jeff Bridges has been basically just, like, trying to get this movie made for years and years and years and years, and I'm sure he's happy it finally got made, but there's a part of me that's like, I wish that this got made 10 years later when this, like, wave of white stuff would be on the tail end and people would, or 10 years earlier.
It
like,
also makes me think, you know,
make it like every other film.
Someone could make it now, again. Like, there's an not that it's going to happen, but there's an opportunity for someone to make the same exact movie again and make it a completely different movie, because they didn't take any of the book. They just wasted that book to make a movie that isn't it at all. It's not what made it special. And it's
That's so crazy.
Yeah, it's really, I think this might be one of my most disappointing movies of the year.
I mean, to wrap up, I would say, you know, if you haven't read the book and are indifferent or don't remember it or whatever, you don't need to watch a movie. And if you love the book, definitely don't watch the movie.
Yeah, just go read the book. The book is great. I mean, if you accidentally see the movie this week and you haven't read the book, it's no big deal because the book is entirely different. So you can still go read the book, and the book is going to be amazing. So
I say the idea of someone accidentally seeing a movie.
You get dragged into a movie, or I don't know, you walk into the wrong theater.
You did think it felt like maybe you, like, tripped while you were walking, and you just, like, fell into a movie theater scene. You're like,
I'm trying to give people an excuse for if they choose this movie. They could just be like, oops, it was an accident. Perry said it could be an accident.
I mean, I guess I'm with you. Like, it's not a it's not the worst movie I've ever seen. I'm not like, oh my god, or like run in the opposite direction as fast as you can. But I just can't think of any reason to really recommend this.
No, I'm super disappointed. Bummer. Whatever. That's all the time we have for today. You can catch us all over the place. Obviously, we're on YouTube. You're watching us here. We are on Twitter at Popcorn Prosecco. Catch us on Facebook, too, Popcorn Prosecco. We are also on iTunes, and we would like you to rate, review, comment, whatever it's called over there, because the more you do that, the happier it makes us. And am I missing anything? Yes, go to popcornprosecco.com as well, because you could watch over there. We've got audio, we've got video, we've got everything. And then on top of that, you can catch all three of us on the web. Angie, where can viewers find you?
You can find me on Twitter, at AJHAN, and you can find my writing on Slashfilm.
Kristy?
I am a freelancer, so I'm all over the place. I'm at Kristy Puchko on Twitter, KristyPuchko, and you can find my highlights at decadentcriminals.com.
And you can catch me on Twitter. My handle is PNemiroff, and I'm over at Collider.com. So, thank you guys so much for watching, and we'll see you next week.
Mr. Aladdin, sir, have you shot two or three? I'm on the job, you big nabob. You ain't never